we shall see the policy of Aurangzeb and to try to understand the various complexities lying in the policy. The policy of Aurangzeb is a very controversial one even now, and it has continued to be so due to several factors. We'll come to these factors and we'll try to resolve some of the controversies as much as possible with the help of modern research. But before we try to look at this policy, we'll see very briefly the reign of Jahangir and his mentality so far as this religion is concerned. We all know that Jahangir succeeded in 1605 after the death of Akbar through a palace intrigue. After that, one could see his mentality in his own memoir written by him called Tuzuk-i Jahangiri. But in looking at this memoir, we see that his mentality is full of contrasts, full of contradictory things. For example, he began to discuss, and he continued to discuss, with religious leaders of different communities. At the same time, he was very much against Guru Arjun and the Jains, some of whom he punished, as we know. In other places, for example, at Kangra, when he went to see the temple, he did not break the temple, but he sacrificed a bullock there despite the protests of the priests. So there is a kind of contrasting attitude so far as Jahangir is concerned. But in one way, one could say that he was more generous than Shah Jahan and more orthodox than Akbar. For example, in his policy of employment of the Mansabdars, he took more Rajputs from different areas than Akbar had done. Akbar had taken the Kachwas of Rajputs mainly, the Ambar people. But Jahangir had expanded this into Bikaner, into Jodhpur, into many other places. So therefore, there was an expansion of Hindu nobility under Jahangir to a slight extent. Now, Shah Jahan, we do not go into it. We come directly to Aurangzeb, with which we are concerned at the moment. Aurangzeb, as we all know, has remained a controversial ruler. Whether he was a successful ruler, there are differences of opinion. Pakistani historians found him very much successful. But English historian of the 19th century like Elphinstone, or the Hindu historian Jodhanath Sarkar of the 20th century, they found that he was a bad ruler, because due to his policy, the Mughal Empire declined. He became anti-Hindu, in contrast to the liberalism of Akbar, and Hindus were alienated, they rebelled, and the Mughal Empire fell. But we have to remember that after Aurangzeb died in 1707, and the Mughal Empire continued 150 years after that. So it is very difficult to accept this kind of theory, and as we shall see, that the recent researches do not support this anti-Hindu theory of Aurangzeb. But we'll start with generalization, as we have done. And now we see that Aurangzeb's period has been divided into two halves. One is from his accession to 1669, and the other is from 1670 to his death, 1707. In the first half, Aurangzeb is seen as more or less not a very liberal person, but he did not persecute the Hindus at all. As a matter of fact, some of the Hindus got very high posts during this period. In the second period, in the second half, it is stated that he became a very orthodox man, leaned towards the orthodox ulemas due to the failures, political failures and so on. This was the division that Professor Arthur Ali has done in his book Mughal Nobility under Aurangzeb, and we'll see some of these things later. Regarding the controversy of whether Aurangzeb was responsible, his anti-Hindu policy was responsible for the decline of the Mughal Empire, there are some doubts nowadays. Modern researchers like Sayyid Nurul Hasan, Irfan Habib, Satish Chandra, Arthur Ali had shown that there is a different aspect of the crisis. There was a crisis during the later years of Aurangzeb, and this was principally the economic crisis. Although these scholars differ from one another in detail, for example, Irfan Habib thinks it is an agrarian crisis. Arthur Ali and Nurul Hasan think that this is due to Jagirdari crisis. Whatever it is the economic crisis of the Mughal Empire. Therefore, it is beyond the hope of a person to salvage the whole thing. So one could therefore, in the very beginning, could say that there are more things there. There are more aspects there than merely anti-Hindu policy. Now, Aurangzeb's entire period, so far as his religious and social and religious attitude is concerned, we can divide into four stages. Although one stage overlaps one another, it is by the measures that we come to this division. One is the general attitude. Second is his temple policy. Third is his jizya. And the fourth is employment of the Mansabdars. In the first stage, the general attitude, we see that Aurangzeb abolished certain rules. For example, he abolished the sijda, S-I-J-D-A, sijda, which is the prostration of the noble before the emperor. He thought it is un-Islamic and he abolished it. This was a Persian practice that was being followed and this was abolished now. Then he abolished the kalima, which is written in the coins, on the ground that the coins are sometimes trampled under the feet. So therefore that has to go. Then he abolished the Nowruz festival, which he says is un-Islamic. It's a pre-Islamic Persian festival, the festival of the new year, and this is gone. Then he abolished the Jharokhai Darshan, that is the emperor standing on the window. This is an old practice started by Akbar, and the practice is, as Abul Fazal had explained earlier, is to show the people that the emperor is living. This is very important because when Shah Jahan became ill, Dara put a slave in the garb of Shah Jahan and put him into the window. So therefore that is also gone. Then in 1670, Aurangzeb banished music from the court. The contemporary Masri Alamgiri, Saki Mustad Khan's book, stated that the musicians took out a procession when Aurangzeb was going to the Jamma Masjid, and when Aurangzeb asked what is the procession, they said we are going to bury the music. This is really a little bit exaggerated. the instrumentation, in playing of the instrument continued in the Nahbat Khana. That was on the Deori or on the door. That still continued. Only the vocal music, particularly in the court, that has been stopped. Incidentally, Aurangzeb was an excellent Veena player. He used to play Veena. He knew music very well. And it was during his time, and perhaps with his sponsorship, that the best Persian work on Indian classical music has been written. So therefore, he is not anti-music at all, as Saki Mustad Khan tried to tell us. But there are other reasons for this. Then there are various certain other reasons, small things, not very big things, like he stopped the writing of the official history from the 10th year. The reason perhaps was economic. He did not want to spend money on this. Then the silver ink pot of the Darbar has been changed to ceramic. Then the gold railing of the Darbar, that has been changed also. So most of these are generally coming due to the economic crisis that was developing. But certain other measures were also taken as part of the general thing. For example, the holy celebration in public place, that was stopped. In private, in one's own house, one can play, but not in public. Similarly, Muharram procession of the Shias, that was stopped also at the same time. So all these measures continued in the general period. And in this general period, one could see that there was some kind of an economic crisis coming. These are all not against the Hindus, but some certainly are. For example, he gave order in 1670 that all Hindu accountants are to be replaced with the Muslim accountants. But this was opposed by the nobles, because the Khatris and the Kayasthas, who used to occupy these places, they were very efficient and they knew the language, they were experienced people, and therefore they objected to it, and Aurangzeb had to change his order. But for some, he helped them. For example, he appointed an official called Mahatasib, M-U-H-T-A-S-I-B, Mahatasib. Mahatasib is to look after the public moral of the citizen, but he's also look after the weights in the market. He's also to look after the wall of the city, the surrounding wall of the city, the bridges and so on and so forth. So we find in the general attitude, it was not anti-Hindu totally. In case of the temple, this is of course a very controversial one. The Shariat says that if the Zimmis are there, that is the Hindus or Christians who are called Zimmis, and if they remain loyal, they can perform their religious function. But at the same time, it is stated in the Shariat that the old temples are to be destroyed, and to construct a new temple, the permission of the emperor is necessary. Now, Aurangzeb made a firman of this and gave it. The problem is that what is the definition of the old temple? How old it would be old? 10 years, 12 years, 25 years, 50 years, 1,000 years? Nobody knows. And it all depends on the qazis or the local people to decide which one is old or which one is not. Similarly, he ordered to the destruction of some temples. For example, those temples which had been destroyed earlier, like the temple of Somnath, he found that worship has started, and he stopped it, destroyed the temple fully. So therefore, in the temple policy of Aurangzeb, he had followed a certain policy based on the Shariat. old temples are not destroyed. But later on he gave the order that temples more than 12 years old should not be destroyed. At the same time we see that Aurangzeb is having problem, war actually, with the Marathas and the Jats. But in those areas, he began to destroy the temples as part of the punishment policy. And as a result, the Hindus got more alienated, more and more alienated because of this. So therefore, in the temple policy, it is more or less clear. But the ulemas, they began to force him to do something. For example, in case of the temple at Vrindavan and the temple at Mathura, the Mathura one was constructed during the time of Jahangir. These two were destroyed on the ground, and perhaps on false ground, that the anti-Islamic propaganda is being carried on there. J.H. Farooqi in his book has given this reason, but he has not given any evidence to show that the anti-Islamic propaganda was going on. Whatever the reason, the temple policy remains clear. But till 1669, we see that Aurangzeb was far more liberal. In December 1669, we have a report of a Frenchman from Surat. He said that Qazi had destroyed a temple. Qazi of Surat had destroyed a temple. And in protest, the Hindu merchants had all left Surat and had gone to Cambay. The matter had reached the ears of Aurangzeb. He immediately transferred the Qazi and the Hindus had come back. So after 1669, December, this was the policy. But the same Frenchman who has been living in India, a merchant of the East India Company, said that later on, this did not happen again. No Qazi was later transferred. So therefore, in the temple policy, there was a slight change. And as we go towards the second half, as we see more and more Aurangzeb getting involved in the wars against the Marathas, Jats, etc., there are more temple destructions than earlier. In case of jizya, jizya is a Roman word called gezit, G-Z-I-T. It means a tax for non-Romans. It's a poll tax for non-Romans. Now, this jizya was used in the Sultanate for some time. Because in the Shariat, it is clearly given that the Jimmis would pay jizya. During the time of Aurangzeb, in 1670 onwards, jizya was introduced. As we know, Akbar had abolished it in 1564, and in 1670, this was reimposed. Now, the jizya are three types of taxes. First is per year, per person, on the basis of his property other than land, rupees 3 1/3. Second type, rupees 6 1/3. And third type, rupees 13 1/3. Now, if we look at the tax structure, we see that it is a regressive tax. Because for a very rich person, rupees 6 1/3 is not much in a year. But for a poor weaver, for example, or a tailor or somebody like this, this is 1 month's salary. So therefore, for the poor, it is more of a burdensome than for the rich. But that was not the Hindus actually objected. What the Hindus objected was the way it is collected. The Amins were appointed in every province. They used to go from house to house in the villages. They used to call personally the person to come and pay the tax. And while paying the tax, they were abused. So therefore, what the Hindus objected is not the incident of tax, but the way it is collected. And jizya has created sufficient problem, although jizya has continued even during the British days. For example, the British in Calcutta in early 18th century imposed certain taxes they called jizya, but this is that those were not the religious taxes. Here it's a tax on the property excepting land, depending on the property of the person, the quantum of the property of the person, the value of the property of the person concerned. Jizya was abolished in 1702 from the Deccan because of the struggle with the Marathas. In 1712, it was abolished from North India due to the insistence of Asad Khan and Zulfikar Khan. But it was reintroduced again very quickly, and in 1722, it was finally abolished. Since then, it has not been introduced so far. Now, with the last one now coming, the employment of the Hindus in the Mughal Mansabdari system under Aurangzeb. We have seen that Akbar has started taking the Hindus in the Mughal Empire as Mansabdars. Man Singh, for example, was one of those. He became governor of Bengal twice, became governor of Bengal, governor of Kabul, and more than 5,000 Zat rank, very high rank, so on and so forth. It has been stated by Jagannath Sarkar that Aurangzeb did not make new Hindu Mansabdars. It is inaccurate. It's not a correct one. Roughly the figure is that under Akbar, the percentage of Hindus was 22.6% of the total. Under Shah Jahan, it is more or less the same. Under Aurangzeb, in the first phase, that is, even if we take up to 1678, then we see it is much less, 21.6%. And in the second stage, that is from 1679 to 1707, the Hindu percentage Mansabdar of in the Mansabdari system was 31.6%, the highest so far in Mughal India. And it remained highest in Mughal India. So therefore the question of the not taking the Hindus is inaccurate. Instead of the Rajputs, he certainly imposed certain restrictions on the Rajputs. Instead of the Rajputs, Marathas were taken in large numbers, and 98 Marathas became Mansabdars, out of which 16 became more than 5,000 Zat, 18 became more than 3,000 Zat. So therefore, it is not true that Aurangzeb favored only the Muslims. It is on the contrary, he tried to take the Hindus in the administration. As a matter of fact, we have a letter of Aurangzeb which said that so far as worldly affairs is concerned, there is no relation with religion. So therefore, it would be very difficult to call Aurangzeb anti-Hindu. He is certainly anti-Rajput due to certain reasons, but he is not anti-Hindu. As I have said, that historians, particularly the English historians like Elphinstone and others, and Jagannath Sarkar, etc., they had blamed Aurangzeb for the decline of the Mughal Empire, and they had blamed the religious policy, that is the anti-Hindu policy of Aurangzeb. But compared to the policy of Akbar, Aurangzeb was certainly orthodox. He was against the Shias as well, not only against the Hindus. But we do not find that properly, that excepting in case of the Rajputs, he was not much against the Hindus. Whatever he has done, the question of the struggle with the Marathas and the Jats, these are not due to religion. Because in the Maratha army, there were Muslims. In the Mughal army, there were Marathas, as well as Hindus in case of the Jats in the Mughal army as well. So therefore, it's not a Hindu-Muslim struggle. It's not really that way. It was an economic crisis that was gradually coming in, that was enveloping the Mughal Empire, of which he was merely a clog in the wheel. So therefore, one should have a fresh look at Aurangzeb's policy, particularly his religious policy. He's certainly to be blamed for the destruction of the temples, for the imposition of the jizya. But the jizya did not last long. 1722, it was over. And since then, since the death of Aurangzeb, temples were practically not destroyed anymore. So he did not leave any lasting policy behind the Mughal Empire.